Hello everyone, welcome to this session on osteology of the head and neck. In this session we'll be learning about the cranial cavity. So here we can see the specimen of cranial cavity. In this, the calvaria has been cut open to expose the cranial cavity. Okay, in general the study of cranial cavity can be divided into three regions. This anterior part is referred to as the anterior cranial fossa, intermediate part is the middle cranial fossa, and the posterior part is the posterior cranial fossa. Okay, here we can see these three cranial fossa are arranged stepwise, the anterior cranial fossa being highest, the middle cranial fossa is at an intermediate level, and posterior cranial fossa is at the lowest level. Okay, since there are three cranial fossa, we should know what is the demarcation lines between them. Between anterior cranial fossa and middle cranial fossa, the demarcation line is this. This is the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone, and this is the anterior margin of the sulcus chiasmaticus, which is referred to as limbus sphenoidalis. Okay, so these structures divide the anterior cranial fossa with the middle cranial fossa. And what is the demarcation between middle cranial fossa and posterior cranial fossa? Here we can see this is the petrous part of the temporal bone. This is the hardest part of the skull. Okay, petrous temporal bone, and this is dorsum cellae. These structures divide the middle cranial fossa with the posterior cranial fossa. Okay, now let's study each cranial fossa one by one. So here we can see this is the anterior cranial fossa. Which are the bones visible in the anterior cranial fossa? This is the frontal bone. This part of the frontal bone is referred to as the orbital plate of the frontal bone, and this is the ethmoid bone, and this is sphenoid bone. Okay, so three bones visible in anterior cranial fossa are frontal bone, ethmoid bone, and sphenoid bone. In the ethmoid bone, we can see certain specific features. This elevation here, this is referred to as the crista galli. The anterior end of the fac cerebra is attached here, and adjacent to the crista galli, we can see there are multiple small openings, which is referred to as the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone. Let's zoom in and see. This is the cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone. The ethmoidal foramina, anterior, posterior, those are present here. Okay. And on the inner aspect of the frontal bone, this elevation is seen. This is referred to as the frontal crest. And in between frontal crest and the crista galli, there is a small opening, which is referred to as foramen cecum. Okay. And which opening is this? Opening in the frontal bone, this is frontal air sinus. You can see the outer table of the skull, this is the inner table of the skull. In between them, the space in the frontal bone is frontal air sinus. In other areas, this space, the area in between the two tables of the skull is referred to as diploe. Okay. So we have covered the anterior cranial fossa. Now let's study about the middle cranial fossa. So which are the bones visible in middle cranial fossa? This bone is the sphenoid bone, and this bone is the temporal bone on each side. Okay, so these bones form the middle cranial fossa. The sphenoid bone has got certain characteristic parts. This intermediate part is referred to as the body of the sphenoid. This sharp edge, this is the lesser wing of the sphenoid, and this is the greater wing of the sphenoid bone. Okay, what is the demarcation between lesser wing and greater wing? Here we can see an opening. This opening is referred to as the superior orbital fissure. Medial to the superior orbital fissure, this is the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone, and this is the greater wing of the sphenoid bone, lateral to the superior orbital fissure. This body of the sphenoid bone has got certain characteristic parts. Here this region is referred to as the sulcus chiasmaticus. The anterior margin of the sulcus chiasmaticus is referred to as limbus sphenoidalis. The posterior margin of the sulcus chiasmaticus is the tuberculum cellae. This is referred to as the dorsum cellae. In between tuberculum cellae and dorsum cellae, there is a cavity here. This is referred to as the cella tertica. Okay, here we can see this is cella tertica which lodges the pituitary gland. And there are multiple openings which are seen in the sphenoid bone. Here we can see this opening is the optic canal. Okay, from the optic canal, the optic nerve passes through. So both optic nerve will come and meet here. This is the region of optic chiasma, and that's why the sulcus is referred to as sulcus chiasmaticus. Okay. Then here we can see four openings lying in one line. If we draw an arc like this, these four openings lie in one line. From anterior to posterior, we'll see this is the superior orbital fissure. And this opening is foramen rotundum. And behind foramen rotundum, this is foramen ovale. And behind foramen ovale, the small opening is foramen spinosum. Okay? So four openings lying in one arc. I'll repeat again. Superior orbital fissure, foramen rotundum, foramen ovale, and foramen spinosum. Okay. Then just adjacent to the body of the sphenoid, this opening which is seen, this is foramen lacerum. On the lateral aspect of the body of the sphenoid, we can see a groove here. This is referred to as the carotid groove. The internal carotid artery, it lodges in this groove. That's why this is referred to as carotid groove. Carotid canal is different, carotid groove is different. There is an opening here. This is the carotid canal. I'll try to show in a different angle. You can see this opening. This is the opening of carotid canal. From here, the carotid artery will go in the carotid groove. Okay. So this was about the middle cranial fossa. Now let's study about the posterior cranial fossa. So here we can see this region is the posterior cranial fossa. So which all bones are seen in posterior cranial fossa? This bone is the occipital bone, and this part which is remaining, this is the temporal bone. This part is referred to as the clivus. This is the sloping surface. Here, this sloping surface referred to as clivus is formed by two bones. The upper part is formed by the sphenoid bone, and the lower part is formed by the occipital bone. And the petrous part of the temporal bone on the inner aspect, it shows an opening here. This is the internal acoustic meatus. And this opening which is seen below it, this is the jugular foramen. Okay, this is the jugular foramen. Lateral to the foramen magnum. This large opening is the foramen magnum. And there is a small opening here which is referred to as anterior condylar canal, also referred to as hypoglossal canal. The inner aspect of the occipital bone shows certain characteristic features. Just like on the outer aspect there is external occipital protuberance, similarly on the inner aspect there is internal occipital protuberance. This is the internal occipital protuberance. In this elevation here, this is the internal occipital crest. And the occipital bone lodges some important sinus. This groove is for the transverse sinus, and this groove is for the sigmoid sinus. Okay. So transverse sinus continues as the sigmoid sinus, and sigmoid sinus will go up to this jugular foramen. From the jugular foramen, the sigmoid sinus will continue as the internal jugular vein. Okay. This posterior cranial fossa is entirely occupied by the cerebellum. On the anterior aspect, there is the brainstem. Okay. So brainstem and cerebellum, they occupy the posterior cranial fossa. This middle cranial fossa is occupied by the temporal lobe, and the anterior cranial fossa is occupied by the frontal lobe. Okay. So in cranial cavity, most of the times examiners point out the various openings and they ask the structures pass through these openings. So to learn the structures which pass through the openings, I'll add on slides in this session so that all openings and all structures are covered. Okay. Thank you. This is a specimen of calvaria, also referred to as the skull cap. Study of interior of the calvaria is also included in the study of cranial cavity. So we'll cover that as well. So here we can see the inner aspect of the calvaria. So what all structures are seen? First of all, the bones visible are, this is the frontal bone, and these two are the parietal bones, and some part of occipital bone is also seen. Okay. And on the inner aspect of the frontal bone, the elevation is referred to as the frontal crest. This suture is the coronal suture. This suture is the sagittal suture. And there's a depression here, which is referred to as the sagittal sulcus, which lodges the superior sagittal sinus. Okay. And what are these pits? These pits are referred to as granular pits. These are formed due to the arachnoid granulations. Okay. Arachnoid granulations leads to this formation of pits. Arachnoid granulations are also referred to as pachyonian bodies. Okay. So those cause this pits. These are referred to as granular pits, which are seen on the inner aspect of the calvaria. So these were certain features with respect to the inner aspect of the calvaria. Okay. So we have covered all important features with respect to the interior of the cranial cavity as well as the inner aspect of the calvaria and all the structures passing through the major foramina. Okay. So we'll stop here. Thank you.